When we go outside and look up on a clear, dark night, we can see about 3,000 stars swirling over our heads. It was from this view that for hundreds of centuries, humanity built and framed its understanding of our place in the universe. Looking up and seeing the sun, the moon, the planets, and the stars, all of them, every one, circling around us day after day, year after year, never changing except for the occasional comet or falling star, it seemed a natural conclusion to make that we lie at the center of all that is. After all, why would everything revolve around us if we were not at the center? Surely this makes us somehow special. The notion that we occupy a special place in the cosmos is as old as humanity and remained essentially unchallenged until Nicholas Copernicus presented an idea that perhaps everything did not revolve around us. Maybe, just maybe, he said, things went around the sun instead. With the invention of the telescope, Galileo provided observational evidence to support Copernicus. And for the first time in thousands of years, humanity began to get a sense that perhaps the cosmos wasn't as interested in us as we had always imagined. Human beings come to understand our environment by making observations, and then we filled in the knowledge gaps created by things we can't see directly by making reasonable inferences to explain what's going on, at least as best we can. But what may seem obvious and explain our experiences at first may turn out to have other explanations that are equally plausible, if not always palatable to our sensibilities. So it was that these initial challenges to our place in the universe from Copernicus and Galileo became a difficult consideration, and, not surprisingly, were resisted. As time passed and more data came in from ever-advancing telescopes and mathematics, it became uncomfortably obvious that we were not at the center of everything. The Earth clearly circled the sun, and what's more, it wasn't as flat as it appeared at first glance. In fact, our planet wasn't flat at all. Our planet, we discovered, orbits the sun, and it's one of seven other bodies that do the same. Our sun is one of several hundred billion in a galaxy, and as stars go, it isn't all that large, bright, or hot. All things considered, it too is not very special. We've also recently learned that every star in our galaxy has on average 1.6 planets in orbit around it. Some have more, others less. Solar systems, it turns out, are very common, and also not that special. For decades, as late as the 1920s, astronomers thought we were the only galaxy in the universe, an island in an immense void. Then Edwin Hubble measured variable stars in the Andromeda Nebula and discovered that it wasn't a nebula at all. It was another galaxy. Alas, our galaxy wasn't very special either. The final nail in the coffin for the human-centrist view of the cosmos came when the Hubble Deep Field was taken in 1995. Astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope pointed our most powerful eyes to a tiny area of empty, unremarkable, and starless sky for many days to see if anything would show up. Thousands of galaxies filled the image, showing us for the first time that there are little island universes literally everywhere. Each tiny speck in the image was a galaxy containing hundreds of billions of stars. Most recently, and with relatively little fanfare, a new, enthralling look at our cosmos was released. Astronomers using ground-based telescopes high in the Chilean mountains have given us a picture that dwarfs all previous observations taken so far. Looking in the constellation sextants and staring for 55 hours, we are shown a look into our cosmic home like never before. Constructed from over 6,000 individual images and covering an area of sky about 8 times that of a full moon, the UltraVISTA deep field contains over 200,000 galaxies. This is the widest and deepest image of its kind. With so many galaxies and so many stars, where do we declare the center to be now? And where do we fit in? Finding out we don't occupy any special position in the heavens may be crushing to some and threatening to our old ideas, but this need not be viewed as a bad thing. What our discoveries have shown us is that we are part of something larger than ourselves. We may not be central to eternity, but it is central to us, and our home expands with each new thing we learn about it. The actual universe is far richer than anything we could ever have imagined in our heads, and our home has more neighbors than we thought. What's required of us now is to expand our view of home, to stop limiting what we call home to just one tiny grain in a cosmic sandbox. The Earth is one tiny room in an immense mansion of eternity. If we look at our home that way, then looking up on a clear, dark night is never lonely and always full of possibilities.